But still there's no signs. It's gotta be a trick for the deaf, dumb, and blind, which you set up home and wait for a mystery guard to bring you food, clothing, and shelter. Emphatically no. Mathematically that just don't go. See, me and my people been lost for over 400 years and done tried this mystery guard, and all we got was hard times. Hunger and nakedness from the snake that hits. Beaten and killed by the ones who say look to the sky for your piece of the pie. They didn't want to tell you the gods within self, but suckers of the poor want to keep your wealth, keep you a slave, so you don't misbehave. You never know the truth till you're dead in your grave. That's when you want to come back. But there ain't no hacks, traps, caught you like a good strong buck. Now you're fucked. But my third eye helps me see that the black man's god, yo, it ain't no mystery.
It ain't no mystery. God, have you seen him? You keep searching for a trillion years. Keep spreading dates, but he never appears. Crazy delusions.
Let me just move on. Here in Ohio, we see Holy Quran, what they call Al Quran Mosque, Masjid, or something. It's the Masonic Hall. Okay, Holy Quran Mosque, Masjid. And across the street, we see that they have the lodge, or what they call the temple. Now, as you go up into Masonry, up into the 33rd degree, or you have to at least go up to 32 degrees to become what they call a shrine. Now the shrines are those that swear on the Holy Quran again. They take on Muslim attributes. They wear the fezes. They learn much about our religion. And we find many of the presidents. We find that Monroe, Roosevelt, Johnson, Jackson. We find that Washington. They were all Masons. So they had actually come into some knowledge of the Islamic religion. Nevertheless, in order to become the shrine, it's interesting the way they have it set up. You have the big lodge here, but once you reach a certain point, then you can go across the street into the next one. So one is a temple, the other one, which they say is a mosque, at least on the outside. So this brought to my mind the evolution of the prophets, that we move from the temple. We move from Jesus, who said, he said, destroy this temple, and I will build it up in 3 days. So it shows us the evolution, that he moved from the temple. They moved from Jesus. And when we think of the temple, we have temples right here on our head. And one of their signs is to point to the temple. And they talk about the great temple of Solomon. And as I pointed out, they had two pillars, one on the right, one on the left, supporting the temple. So this is one of their signs representing these signs, the spiritual and the material. We have two ears and one sound, the conscious and the subconscious. And as Muslims, we salam to the right and we salam to the left. Is that correct? So, nevertheless, now they move from one to the other. Now we see from Jesus, he spoke of a comforter. So you move from the temple. You move from the pulsation. You see the emotionalism. See, here is a pulsation. And you move into a masjid. You move into a place where there's worship, where there's teaching, the ta'lim, where there's teaching, where there's learning, where there's instruction. So you move from just an emotionally spiritual a person, and you move into a rational person seeking knowledge and light. So it's interesting that I noticed that they move from their temple and they come across and they come to the mosque, which points out that you move from Jesus, because they have the 33rd degree system, which represented the life of Jesus. They say he died at 33 or somewhere there's about. So at his death, then we had Prophet Muhammad's birth. So they come from the 32nd degree lodge and they walk over into the mosque, according to what they call it. Now it's not a mosque, but they do learn about Islam. So you move from Jesus and you come into Muhammad. Now they say, I'm not an artist, so just use some of your imagination. They have the shrine of the Greek, and on the shrine of the emblem is the so-called crescent. And in between the crescent, they have the sphinx. And over that, they have the sword. Now the sphinx and the base of the pyramid, as I pointed out, have accepted a god of the physical world. They've accepted these elements. The shrine of symbol is the crescent. and they have this sphinx in the middle. But over the sphinx is the sword. And when we, what do we say about the sword? It represents the sacred word. We know that the sacred word of truth rules these elements. They say that it's over it. If you look at the sword, it just doesn't mean, according to their language, technically, they say it represents the setting of the old world and the rising up of the new world, of the Islamic world. But when you go deeper into their symbolism, they know that the sword is the sword of truth, the S word, the sacred word. It is the sacred word. Once we come into the sacred word, even these so-called elements, now I'm not talking about the physical elements, I'm talking about as they relate to us. We need something to rule our moral nature, our spiritual nature, our material aspect, and the wisdom, so that we won't walk around boastful thinking we're God. Allah is God, and that's what rules over that, because you can rise to a point, as Pharaoh did. He said, come on, Moses, who is this God you're talking about? Come on, I'm the only God. He told his people, go build me a temple. I want to...
It's a pleasure to be here, and I'd like to thank you for granting me the opportunity to share some time with you and to share what I have come into and to perhaps also benefit from what you have. So we may share with one another so that inshallah we may grow in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, and we may better be able to propagate and to live the religion of al-Islam. I'd like to first start by reading from the Quran. Well, the brother referred to me as a scholar, and brother, I really appreciate that, but I don't consider myself that as of yet. Inshallah, maybe one day I will be worthy of such a title. However, I do consider myself as a brother and friend in trying to do dawah and propagation to make the religion clear to Muslims who may not be too clear about it, but most importantly, to non-Muslims in America and throughout the world. Because as the brother has mentioned, there's been great attempts, great plots on the part of this government, on the part of Zionists as well, who in fact perhaps have been the leaders in misrepresenting the religion and giving a false impression of our religion. So inshallah, I'd like to make some type of contribution in helping to fight against such diabolical plans and diabolical schemes. And inshallah, hopefully in my lifetime, I can do something about that. And inshallah, we all can work together to do something about that. Our model, human being, is Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him. And we know that he was strong, fearless. Allah raised him up to proclaim the message. And on that, I'd like to go to Surah 15 of Al-Quran. We made a couple of ayats first. Start with ayat 89, but I'm going to emphasize on 94. And say, I am indeed he that wanteth openly and without ambiguity of just such wrath as we sent down on those who divided scripture into arbitrary parts. So also on such as have made the Quran into shreds, as they please. Therefore, by the Lord, we will of a surety call them to account for all their deeds. Therefore, expound openly what thou art commanded, and turn away from those who join false gods with Allah. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Allah commissioned him to warn the people, to proclaim the message openly, to make it clear and open. And we who call ourselves Muslims, we who adhere to the dictates of the Holy Quran, we who accept Prophet Muhammad as our model human being, we must do the same thing. We must be about proclaiming the message openly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, mix not of truth with falsehood, nor conceal the truth when you have come into it. So our obligation is to make the message plain and to preach it openly. And I'm trying to emphasize that because I want to deal with the subject on Freemasonry and on secrecy and concealing of the message. I'm going to read from Hadith 13, where the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, none of you truly believe until he wishes for his brother what he wishes for himself. If we have knowledge, wisdom, understanding, if we have insight, it is our obligation as brothers, if we say we are Muslims and believers and belong to one community, to share that knowledge amongst ourselves and to share it with the broader community. Allah the Most High say, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, as well as in yourselves, are instructive signs for those who reflect, for men of faith. If we can draw our attention very closely and very briefly to one of the signs or signs in Allah's creation, we see the sun as a ball of light, as a ball of energy, and with great rays that has a great impact on the earth. The sun's responsibility is to give life to the dead. As we place seeds in the ground and the conditions, the proper conditions exist, the sun strikes it and it draws it up, giving life, pulling it up out of the earth. We see this. We see that the sun gives us vitamin and energy for our life. It feeds the plants. The plants take in the light and through the process, energy and it's food. So we see that the sun is a symbol of openness, of freedom, of charity. It shines on everyone. And for those that it don't shine on, it definitely has an impact on our lives because it has an attracting and pulling power. You see, it contributes to the centrifugal force, the spinning of the planets. So we see there a sign of openness, of our need to be charity and to teach the message. We also see in the elements, we see how the water is drawn up from the earth by the sun. And we see it rises up into the heavens and it condenses and forms clouds. Then here comes the wind and moves it from a wet, fertile area and it moves it to a dry, distilled area. And the water just rains down. So the elements, the signs we see in Allah's creation, amongst other things, that we are to be about sharing, giving, and taking. That's our responsibility, to share the message. We read in the history of the Prophet Muhammad, where the Quraysh tribe and the pagans, their primary concern was to keep the message that the Prophet Muhammad had to deliver, to keep it silent, to keep it crushed, to keep the people from getting the pure message. And we see that same mentality here in America and in the world. They're trying as best they can to keep the knowledge of this Quran, of this perfect book here, of our Prophet Muhammad, of the religion of Al-Islam, to keep it hidden, to keep it a secret. And this is what they do in their secret society. In the Masonic Order, in the opening ceremony, concerning the position of the officers in the lodge, the question is asked concerning the worshipful master. He is the leader of the lodge, but his title is worshipful master. Now we know none is worthy of worship but Allah, but this is the title that they have bestowed upon. His responsibility, and what is his station? The question is asked. Well, the answer is given. His position is in the east. Why in the east? It said, because as the sun rises in the east to govern and rule the light of day, so does the worshipful master sit in the east to govern and rule the light. Now, that's not appropriate, because his responsibility is in the lodge. He's not giving light to the brothers and sisters who are not in the lodge. He's confined to the lodge, only to give the message to those who come to him within the lodge. The sun doesn't discriminate on those bases. So we see they have this symbol, but it's not clearly understood. It's not clearly articulated. So they're concerned with secrecy. Their main purpose is secrecy. We find as they go up the ladder to become shrines. Again, I want to emphasize this because they're playing games with our religion. And at the same time, they're taking certain good points of the religion in the shrine degree. In order to be a shriner, if the shriners are those who you may see with the pheasants, marching down the street in their parades, Salam Temple, Mecca Temple, Holy Quran Mosque, they're not Muslim, but they come out and present themselves as such. Nevertheless, they learn about the Kaaba. They learn about the history of Abraham and Ishmael. They learn about the Holy Quran. They learn the great history of our religion. They take oath, and this is a fact. It is proven. We can document it. We've got the ancient Arabic order of the nobles of the mystic shrine ritual, one from Chicago, one from Washington. I got another one from New York to verify what we had come into. And we find in their ritual that they swear on the Holy Quran in the name of Allah not to reveal the secret, not to reveal the message of Al-Islam. Now, why is this important? While we talk about Freemasonry, brother, we have the Quran, we have the Sunnah, that's all we need. But we're living in a world where people are coming against our religion. We live in a world where we have to make the message known to other people. In order to move in the world, we must know what forces we're dealing with. We must know about the hand, the secret hand of tyranny, the hidden forces of tyranny, the hidden forces of oppression. So in their Masonic lodge, in the shrine in Greece, again, in order to be a shrine, the Masonic lodge has two sides. The York Rite, when you come up about 7 degrees, you have to be a Knights Templar. On the York Rite side, in order to be a shrine, you have to be a 32nd degree Mason on the Scottish Rite. That's the 33rd degree system. Okay? Now, when they meet, they come in and they form what they call the Mystic Shrine. The African Americans is the ancient Egyptian Arabic order of the nobles of the Mystic Shrine. The Caucasian is the ancient Arabic order of the nobles of the Mystic Shrine. What shrine are they talking about? They're talking about the Shrine of Islam. Let me just read briefly from one of their documents to show you. Again, why is it important? The majority of the presidents in this land have been Masons. The majority of the vice presidents, Masons. The signers of the Declaration of Independence, Masons. The framers of the Constitution, Masons. We live in this country. These things form their thoughts, form their value system, form their views. So we must know what is going on because they have concept for my religion. Here, in this book here, one statement which is made. Who but Muhammad, they say, mingled his religion with his warriors, with his women, and said this is indeed paradise. This is what we find in their shrine book, amongst other things. What we find here also, I'm going to read it to you, I underline it, to make sure. And this is directly from the Quran. You brothers here, you can probably find the surah quicker than I can. It say, wherefore their work shall not avail. Do they not travel through the earth and see the end of those who were before them? That's Quranic, am I right? That's directly from the Quran. Then right down here says, there are Muslims among us. There are others who swerve from prophecy. But whoso seeketh Islam earnestly, seeks true direction, but those who swerve from truth and justice shall merit and reap abundance of chastisement. This is what the presidents of the United States, Roosevelt and others, have taken oaths on, statements that they have committed themselves to. So, is it not important to us? Is this not so-called the leader of the free world, this country here, the leaders of the free world? But yet, they propagate throughout the media that Muslims are infidels, Muslims are terrorists, Muslims, they're racist. Their only concern is with black people. They're not concerned with anything else. Muslims treat their women bad, but at the same time, they go in their secret concessories, their secret chapters, their secret chambers, their dark chambers, and they swear on the Holy Quran. And I thought it would be very important to start at the shrine degree. That's at the top. This is after they've gone through all that they went through. Then they finally get this Quran on the altar with the Bible, and they take their oath, and they have their various signs. They say they're crossing the burning sands. They say, have you traveled from where to where, from west to east, over the hot burning sands of Arabia? Will you stop? Where will you stop? At the devil's pass? What shrine are you going to worship? At the shrine of Islam? Did you walk or did you ride? I rode. What did you do after you dismounted? I tied my camel to where? To a date tree where all noble men tie their camels, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They learn it, they know this, but at the same time, they come before the world, and what do they say? The Iranians, they're savages. The Iranians have taken our hostages. No travel to Libya. No, Muslims, no. Stay away from Muslims. But they have shown us, and they have been exposed for making deals with Iran. But even more important with deals with Iran, they've sent a Bible to Iran outlining the similarities of all three religions, showing that they know there's a commonality, showing that they know Islam is not a pagan religion, and knowing that they know that Islam is the answer for the liberation of our people.
That's right.
They know that Islam starts you out on equal footage. It says all men are equal. This is what Quran says. We are descendants of Adam, and he created Adam from dust. And he said he created us in the best of mold. So hearing that from God, we won't let no one enslave us. We don't care where they come from. So that's why they don't want to sign in. Because this message in Shabbat, we want to reach not just Muslims. We wanted to reach our Christian brothers and sisters, our atheist brothers and sisters, whatever persuasion they're in. We're going to speak in certain terminology.